This is the day the Lord hath made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. I'm Bob Payne, your worship leader this morning, and welcome to Calvary. Whether you're a first-time visitor, a lifelong member, whether you're online or here in person, we're glad you're here. If you are a visitor and you have any questions about the service or anything about the church, please see myself or Pastor Beth after the service, and we'd be glad to help you. If you take a minute, we can know your presence if you would fill out the worship or the prayer request card in front of you and put that in the offering plate at that time. Then we can celebrate your presence with us. At this time, we'd like to prepare our hearts and minds for worship as we bring in the light of Christ and listen to the prelude. Stand as you're able and join me in the call to worship. We gather today to remember and proclaim that we are God's people.
We are God's people. God's presence is among us.
Like Moses, we seek an encounter with God's goodness.
God, show us your goodness, that we may glorify you.
God's goodness passes by us every day in the gracious gifts of creation and in the faces of our neighbors.
God, help us notice your goodness in everything and everyone that we meet.
When we notice God's goodness all around us, we recognize this truth: all things are God's.
Let us give to God the things that are God's.
Thank you. like to welcome you here to Calvary. I'm Pastor Beth, and some ministry invitations and celebrations in the life of the church. Hey, Bill, could you do me a favor? Look at the announcement slides and see if you can find the Naomi and Ruth one that's labeled there. So yesterday morning, our ladies, which are compiled of our two women's groups that used to meet before COVID hit, Ruth and Naomi, they met up at What a Day Cafe. And Miss Gail sent me this picture last night, and I said, wow, that's a pretty good turnout for 9:30 on Saturday. I will gladly admit that I was doing housework at this time, but Saturday is my one day that I get to do that kind of stuff. So I'm really, really, really excited about this opportunity. Women of all ages getting together and sharing in fellowship and mission, specifically because I know the hearts of many of these ladies around that table, and I know mission will be a big part of this component. So if you are interested in knowing more about Naomi and Ruth, which I think may be rebranded and reimagined, please talk to Ms. Gail or Renee back here. They're sitting right here. We've got coffee and snacks after service, so they'll be here to answer any questions. But be on the lookout for some exciting activities that they have coming up. Also, inside your bulletin, there are announcements and upcoming events. Next week is our Harvest Festival, so it is our way of celebrating the spirit of All Hallows Eve and all the good things. So we're inviting kids to come out in their costumes. Our Ad Council has taken this on, so we've got representatives from each of the areas of ministry that are going to be decorating doors, kind of our version of a trunk or treat. So kids can come and have a safe place to trick or treat. Each one of the doors will be a stopping point where they can show off their costumes, get some candy. Our Boy Scout troop is going to be manning the bonfire out there where we will have hot dogs and s'mores. So there'll be a hot dog fixings table where you can make your own hot dog and enjoy some fellowship and some time outside, weather permitting. If it's not nice, we'll be inside in the fellowship hall. But we've also got some crafts and things like that scheduled in the fellowship hall. So we invite everybody out next week, 5:30 to 7:30 here in the church. P.M., not A.M., just so we're clear. We also, next Sunday morning, will be blessing prayer shawls. So a number of prayer shawls have come in, and when I get, you know, a pile of them, we like to bless them together and worship together. So if you are working on one, or maybe you're just finishing it, we can bless it while you finish it. So bring it on Sunday, and we will do that. We also are celebrating All Saints Day in 2 weeks, so if you have lost a loved one in the past calendar year, we invite you to come forward and speak their name and light a candle in their memory. And our love offering for the entire month of October, so this week and next week, is for the Board of Child Care, which is a United Methodist entity that helps children that have been displaced for various reasons. And they have a couple of residential facilities throughout the state of Maryland. We've specifically been focusing our efforts in West Virginia because it's kind of closest to us here in that area. But we encourage you to use those love offering envelopes that are in front of you to give generously so we can provide Christmas gifts for the children that are at the residential centers. We still have our Thursday night music with Miss Ella, so if you have children that are interested in making a joyful noise at 7 o'clock for a half an hour, they get a special music class with Miss Ella, who is the director of the Opus Music School in Sykesville. And then at 7:30, we are still looking for adult and youth singers. We would like to enrich our worship here on Sunday mornings, and so we need some voices. We'd love to have you guys out and join us for that. Just on the side, if you're cleaning out anything, like I cleaned my garage out this weekend, if you have things for the yard sale, the youth are going to be putting their yard sale on the first Saturday in November. And we're going to be collecting those items. We've partnered with the Penmar organization, which is an organization that uses our church during the week. They're going to be accepting your items on Friday afternoon into the evening. We'll have some youth and adults here collecting items as well. So that'll all be in the fellowship hall. So as you are setting things aside, we're looking for nice things, because that tends to do better and we make more money. But all the proceeds from that go towards our youth mission trips. We have two that are being scheduled right now, planned, one to Camp Hope again, assuming all goes well with Camp Hope and they are active this summer. And the other one is back to Appalachia Service Project, which could be anywhere in the five states of the Appalachian Mountains. So lots going on in the life of the church. We encourage you to be involved as much as possible. And with that, I'm gonna invite the kids to come up for family time. Miss Ella gave me my family time this morning as she came in, because one of the things I was going to talk to you guys about, I printed it all out. So you guys, How much do you listen to your mom's meetings when she's in ad council? So Sheena is our secretary of the administrative council, and we still do these on Zoom and at home. So here, and do you listen to a lot of what, I'm just wondering.
Not really.
Not really? It's just in one ear and out the other. Okay, so one of the things that we've been talking about as a leadership team in administrative council, which is kind of the lay leadership of the church, because in the Methodist church, it's not just me. I have a whole committee of lay people that serve as leadership to the church. So it is a partnership, and that is the way John Wesley, who was the founder of Methodism, set this up, is that we have a partnership that we work with. So I'm not like, I don't get to be the principal here. I'm kind of like the assistant principal, and I have all these other assistant principals with me. And we've been working on mission and vision. Have you ever heard of that? What's a mission and a vision? Well, sometimes when you have an organization, that organization exists and nobody knows what it's about. Nobody understands what the purpose of that organization is. So like Girl Scouts, for example. I mean, you guys kind of know what your mission and vision is when you do your Girl Scout promise, right? That's your mission and vision statement, really, for, and the church has that too. It's just sometimes it gets lost in the shuffle. Sometimes we kind of lose our identity. Like, are we a family church, or are we a senior citizen church, or are we a community church? So we're all trying to figure out what we are. And I thought you guys could help me, because this is what I've got. I've got 2 pages of work that I've been working on. This is what I've been working. This is what I do Monday through Friday, just in case you guys wonder what pastors do other than Sunday. But there were 4 things that we talked about over the summer: acceptance, hospitality, fellowship, and service. Like, those were like the 4 pinnacles I see as this congregation. And then there's some more things that I've added to this, so it's actually, it ends up being 8 points. But I would love to know what you guys think as far as what is Calvary to you? Like, how do you see us in the community? Is it a place where people can come and play and have fun, like the Harvest Festival? So that would fall into that fellowship category. Is it a place where we have coffee and tea and potlucks and, like, sometimes cake and candy? So that's like hospitality, but we also take care of people, right? So like our outside groups. Is it a place where you think people can come and feel accepted, no matter where they come from in their life or whatever their story is? Okay. So the other thing we're talking about this morning is how God appears in our lives. So we know how the church shows up, but sometimes we get lost in the whole, how does God show up, right? God's a hard thing to pin down and figure out. So one of the things that Miss Ella brought this morning, she always brings me some fun things. Do you know what these are?
Walnuts.
Walnuts? Do you know what they are? They're figs, all right? And so when I asked, because Miss Ella and her husband Bagus, they grow all sorts of fun things, and they have some cool stuff in their garden. So they grew these. These are actually figs that they grew. God sometimes is surprising. God shows up in really surprising ways. And that's kind of like when you taste something for the first time. So I had to ask Miss Ella, do I peel it? What do I do? She said, no, you hold the stem. Are you guys brave enough to do this with me? Because, I mean, that's how, is anybody? I'm going to do it by myself? Will you do it if I do it? Huh? Seriously? All right, so she said I didn't. Oh, David, always. All right. So she said, you just hold it by the stem, right? And if I pinch it, I might get 2 out of it.
Okay.
Pull it apart. Okay. So that's a fig.
Pretty. Mmm.
Are you sure you don't want to share this with your sister?
Yeah.
It's pretty good.
You want to try? Have you ever had a fig Newton?
Oh, they're very good. You want to try it? Are you sure?
Yes.
Okay. I'm just, anyway, the point of the message is sometimes God shows up in unexpected ways, right? And, all the time, life isn't always so perfect. Like, honestly, I'm not a veggie girl, so when she handed me, I was like, I don't know. But you have to open things up. You have to unwrap things. You have to do that with church, too, which is why we have to figure out this mission and vision statement for us. And you guys have to be part of that, too, because guess what? I'm not going to say you're the future of the church. You guys are already the church. And that is a nonsense statement that we need to get rid of as a church, talking about kids being the future. They are the church. And in order for us to stay relevant and able to connect with our community, we need to get out of that mindset of we're building something for them. They're already here. They are the church. And God comes at us and with us and through us in unexpected ways, and sometimes ways that you don't want to check out right away. But you've got to open it up to find out what's inside. Find out what the fruit is. Find out what the promise is of that organization or that church or whatever it is that you're looking for in God. Okay? You sure you want to take it? It actually was really yummy.
You can get it for someone.
They only come once a year.
They only come once a year. I'm going to send that home with you.
Yeah.
Because I got one. David got one. Yeah. You guys can, well, you know, your dad might like it.
Yeah.
Mom and dad will eat them. Anyway, will you guys pray with me? All right. Heavenly Father, we give thanks for the ways in which you reveal yourself to us. So as we search for ways to be your hands, your feet, your heart, your voice in this world, give us all that we need as a church, as a community, as individuals, to be the people that you've called us to be, whether that is expected or unexpected. Help us to bring the fruit forward of our work and our labors and our hearts in this day and every day. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you, guys. That's pretty good.
This is a time in our worship when we are invited to share a portion of what we have to help further God's work on earth. May we pray. Holy God, source of every good gift, the tithes and offerings we bring to you are simply a token of our desire to walk more closely beside you. We give, knowing that rendering unto you what is yours would mean leaving everything at your altar, all we have and all we are. We are not there yet, but with your help, we are on the road to getting there. Bless what we give. May it speak words of compassion, mercy, and love as it empowers your mission and ministry. We pray this in the powerful name of Jesus, whose light we seek to follow. Amen. Please join me in the responsive prayer of confession. Let us now come before God together to confess the ways we have missed the mark, seeking forgiveness and reconciliation with God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not given you the things that are yours. We quibble over technicalities and argue over questions that do not lead us to love you, ourselves, or our neighbors well. We ignore your goodness that is all around us, and we do not allow ourselves to be filled with the Spirit who empowers us to live as people who glorify you. We do not recognize your holy touch in the world around us, and we neglect our responsibility to treat all things and all people as sacred. Forgive us, we pray, and free us to live in love and peace with you, with ourselves, with our neighbors, and with all creation.
Lord, as we come before you, as we lift our voices, help us to sit into this space and this time where we give you our love. Too often in prayer, we come to you with our supplications, with the things that we need, with the list of people that we pray for. And so, Lord, we spend this time lifting our hearts to you, giving ourselves to you, asking you for forgiveness in the ways in which we have fallen short. Because no matter who we are, we fall short. Lord, we come before you as a humbled people, watching horrific things happen in this world around us. And oftentimes feeling helpless, lost, discouraged. And so we come to this space of prayer and this space of worship to find the courage to lift our eyes, to see the pain, to comfort those who are even more lost and lonely than we are. Lord, we pray for the places in this world that are sitting in the crossfires of violence and destruction. We pray for the mothers and the fathers and the children. We ask, Lord, for your peace and for your forgiveness and for your redemption. As we seek to become the community that can challenge the injustice in this world, we give thanks for the willingness and the hearts of women to gather around a table to share coffee and conversation, but with a willingness and a heart for mission. We ask, Lord, that you continue to multiply that feeling amongst us, to help us find ways in which we can be of service to you. And we call upon you, Lord, to pour out your blessings upon all of those who gather in this space. Not just on Sundays, but Monday through Friday, even the cleaning service that comes on Friday evenings. We ask that this place be blessed by you and given hope and love and joy, especially, Lord, into the season of the holidays and of gathering and thankfulness. And so for all those who are hurting today, Lord, we pray. We ask you to give us all we need for the challenges and for the hopefulness of the future. As we pray that prayer your Son Jesus taught us all to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who've trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Exodus chapter 33, verses 12 through 23, Moses and the glory of the Lord. Moses said to the Lord, "You have been telling me, 'Lead these people,' but you have not let me know whom you will send with me. You have said, 'I know you by name,' and you have found favor with me. If you are pleased with me, teach me your ways so I may know you and continue to find favor with you. Remember that this nation is your people." The Lord replied, "My presence will go with you, and I will give you rest." Then Moses said to him, "If your presence does not go with us, do not send us up from here. How will anyone know that you are pleased with me and with your people unless you go with us? What else will distinguish me and your people from all the other people on the face of the earth?" And the Lord said to Moses, "I will do the very thing you have asked, because I am pleased with you and I know you by name." Then Moses said, "Now show me your glory." And the Lord said, "I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you, and I will proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I will have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." But, he said, "You cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live." Then the Lord said, "There is a place near me where you may stand on a rock. When my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft in the rock and cover you with my hand until I have passed by. Then I will remove my hand and you will see my back, but my face must not be seen. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Lord God, for the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts, may they be acceptable to you. Amen. So today we delve into this profound encounter between Moses and God, one of my favorite stories from the Old Testament scriptures. This encounter, it offers us valuable insights into our quest to adjust our vision, to see God in the world around us, and to recognize that things that are God's, even in the most surprising places and things and people. The yearning to know God intimately. This word intimate is usually reserved for, you know, relationships between man and wife, or, you know, boyfriend, girlfriend, or whatever, intimate. I love this idea of having an intimate connection with God, because that's what we're seeking. We're seeking something deeper, more profound, an intimate connection with God. That intellectual connection that you find when you have found your soulmate, for example, someone who you can share everything with, and they somehow just get you. So this story begins with Moses, who, like many of us, desired to know God more, to know God more intimately. Moses seeks to experience the glory of the divine, a deep yearning for a tangible connection with God's presence. I think in some cases we all have felt that need and that yearning, perhaps in times of need, in times of grief, in times of loss and loneliness. This is what Moses is seeking, this intimate connection. And we too often find ourselves longing for a deeper connection with our Creator, a desire to witness God's glory in our lives. For those moments that we say, God, just give me a sign, we're looking for that connection. And God's response, this lesson in God's presence. You see, in response to Moses' request, God reveals an essential truth. While we may seek and desire to see God's face directly, there are limits to our understanding and capability. For the 5 seconds that I stepped into the Seekers this morning, we were struggling with this, want to know more, but yet not having the understanding of being able to understand the magnitude of who God is. You see, God, in his infinite wisdom, agrees to show Moses his goodness to proclaim the name of the Lord, a sign of his presence. However, God also reminds Moses that seeing his face directly is beyond human capacity, for it would be overwhelming. It's not the only place we see this in the scriptures, that taking in all of the magnitude of who God is would be too much for our human spirit. And this teaches us that there are aspects of God's glory and presence that transcend human comprehension. We may not always see God's face, but we can experience God's goodness and feel God's presence in our lives. God, in God's love and grace, grants us moments of profound connection, even if they are not face-to-face encounters. So we find ourselves in a space of needing to adjust our vision to see God, to see what is God's. And this falls into place, too, with our vision as a community of faith, too. We constantly need to be adjusting our vision, seeing children as the church and not just our future. As we adjust our vision to see God in the world around us, we must recognize that God is always present. You don't have to ask him to show up. God is always present, even when God's face isn't directly visible. God's glory is not limited to the spectacular, to the Christmas and Easter stories, but it is present with us every day, in everyday moments of our lives. God's presence is known in acts of kindness, in moments of joy, and even in the midst of the moments of trials. Mr. Rogers gives us that reminder that even in the midst of trials and destruction and violence, look for the helpers. And in those circumstances, you see the face of God. So we need to adjust our vision so that we can recognize the things that are God's. In this encounter, Moses, in his passionate plea to God, illustrates an important truth. We ourselves and the people around us are the things that are God's. We are all God's creation, intricately designed and filled with divine potential. The people around us, around you right now, even the surprising ones, are also God's creation, deserving of love and respect and dignity. So we must learn to recognize the image of God in every person we encounter. And in doing so, we embrace our role as bearers of God's light, spreading God's love and grace to a world in need. It is one of the most challenging parts of being a person of faith, is to recognize God in every single face that you encounter. But with persistence and humility in our relationship with God, we see that Moses' persistence in seeking that closer encounter with God can be instructive for us as well. See, while God does set limits, God also honors the deep yearning of Moses' heart. Moses reminds us that it's okay to desire more of God's presence in our lives. However, it's vital to approach this desire with humility, recognizing that we are not equals with the Almighty. We are in relationship with God. We have a reciprocal relationship with God. When we step into relationship with God, there are things that God requires of us, but we are not equals. So as we reflect on this encounter between Moses and God, we are reminded of the profound intimacy available to us in our relationship with the divine. Although we may not see God's face directly, we can experience God's presence. We can experience God's goodness, and we can experience God's grace in our lives. It's just a call to adjust our vision, to see God in the everyday and to recognize the things that are God's, including ourselves and every person we encounter, no matter how surprising they may be. In the end, we live in this promise of God's covenant, and while we might not yet see God face to face, we continue to see God, knowing that one day we will see God as God is. But until then, let us embrace this journey of faith with persistence and humility, seeking to be vessels of God's grace, of God's love, in a world that hungers for God's presence. Will you pray with me? Lord God, as we seek to be these vessels, open our hearts to you. Open our hearts to this world that is so broken and lost in the moment that we are in, and help us to bring into the fold those who are seeking your love, your grace, your understanding, and your forgiveness. In all the ways, Lord, that you strengthen us, strengthen this community of faith to be a vessel for this community and for all who enter. In your name we pray, amen. I invite you to stand in body or spirit and remain standing for our closing song. Go in peace, knowing that God has created each one of us, divinely, uniquely, intricately made
in his image. Go in peace. Amen.